With the Labour Party's popularity in sharp decline and a resurgent coalition, it seemed yet again that Labour was doomed to end up as another two-termed government. With a clear shot to government, what could stop the Liberals and Nationals winning the 1987 election? Knock knock, it's Queensland! Despite the upset of the 1984 election, Hawke would continue to govern Australia with a strong majority government. Unlike Whitlam, Hawke wasn't subjected to a hostile Senate of coalition members and was able to work with the Australian Democrats, who now held 7 seats, to pass policy. Thus, Hawke would continue his attempts to bring industry and unions together, as well as open up Australia to the global market. Due to winning the balance of power in the Senate 3 times in a row, the Democrats had made a name for themselves as Australia's primary third party. Satisfied with the job he had achieved, Democrats leader Don Chipp would resign in 1986 after 9 years of leading the party. He'd be succeeded by South Australian Janine Haines, the first female leader of a multi-man party in federal government. While the Democrats would have a smooth transition of power, the coalition would experience some of the most vicious leadership tensions in the party's history. Despite outperforming the polls in the 1984 election, Liberal leader Andrew Peacock was finding his popularity on the decline. He found himself frequently clashing heads with his Conservative deputy John Howard. Peacock saw Howard as a threat to his leadership, and after failing to get assurances from Howard that he would not challenge him for the leadership role, Peacock would move to replace Howard as deputy. The party room vote would occur in early September 1985, with Peacock backing the more moderate John Moore for the deputy role. However, Moore would lose to Howard, who continued to hold the number 2 job. Believing that the situation was untenable, Peacock would immediately resign, despite holding the majority of the party's support. This left the leadership role free for Howard to take over as the 7th leader of the Liberal Party. Now it's about time I talk about Howard in detail. Born in 1939, Howard would grow up in Earlwood, Sydney. His mother, Lyle, would be a strong admirer of UK wartime Prime Minister Winston Churchill, which likely influenced Howard to join the Liberal Party in 1957. Howard would take on multiple roles in the party, from helping campaigns to leading the Young Liberals as president. He would eventually enter Parliament himself in 1974, winning the seat of Benelong. Howard would quickly work his way up the Liberal ranks. In 1975, he would help in overthrowing Snedden and getting Fraser elected leader. This in turn would score him the role of Minister for Business and Consumer Affairs in Fraser's government. Howard would soon be promoted to Treasurer 2 years later in the wake of Lynch's scandals. As Treasurer, Howard would push free market economics philosophies, despite Fraser's support of Keynesian practices. By 1985, Howard had firmly centred himself as the leader of the Liberals' conservative faction, and he would begin to move the Liberal Party away from Fraser's economic agenda and towards a more free market one. But with the economy in yet another downturn, it seemed like Howard would have a strong shot at ending yet another short-lived Labour government. However, up north, a new crisis was booming. Let's talk about Queensland, the Sunshine State. In 1949, the Queensland Labour government under Ned Hanlon would pass the Electoral Districts Act, which sought to give smaller regional towns a stronger say in government. Hanlon claimed this was to counteract the giant voting population centres around Brisbane, however most people saw it as gross gerrymandering to benefit the Labour Party. Following the Labour Party split in 1957, the regional voting base had now thrown their support behind the Country Party. This allowed the coalition to continuously win elections throughout the 60s and 70s. In 1968, the Country Party leadership would be taken over by one of the most infamous premiers in Australian history, Joe Bjelke-Petersen. Under his reign, Bjelke-Petersen had turned Queensland into quite the rogue state, opposing any social reform and increasingly using the police to crack down on protests. This led the Queensland Liberal Party to question their support for the coalition and consider the possibility of breaking away and joining the Labour Party to take Bjelke-Petersen down. In 1974, Bjelke-Petersen would rename the Country Party to the National Party in an attempt to broaden the party's appeal. This move was successful and the party began to win urban seats normally held by the Liberal Party. Eventually, the Liberal Party had had enough of Bjelke-Petersen and would end the coalition. However, by this point it was too late, and following the election of 1983, Bjelke-Petersen was eventually successful in governing in his own right, winning a majority of seats for the National Party. The result of the 1983 election had left Bjelke-Petersen extremely ambitious, and he soon turned his attention to federal politics. A campaign called Joe for Canberra would soon be spawned, which sought not only to get Bjelke-Petersen into federal government, but also get him made Prime Minister. To Joe and his supporters, Canberra was full of socialists, hell-bent on destroying the Australian way of life, and only Joe represented true Australian conservative values. Bjelke-Petersen would begin by taking all 12 of the Queensland Nationals' federal candidates out of the coalition and would put pressure on other national branches to do the same. Bjelke-Petersen planned to use the same strategy he had employed in 1983 and would have the Nationals run against Labor and Liberal in urban seats with hopes of forming a federal Nationals government that he would lead. This put pressure on federal Nationals leader Ian Sinclair to follow suit and join the Joe for Canberra campaign. Sinclair would refuse to join the campaign, however several other National members did, and the coalition would fall apart. Joe for Canberra would initially pick up quite a bit of steam from right-wing media bodies such as The Australian, who were attracted to Bjelke-Petersen's proposal of a flat tax rate, which also saw rich Queensland industry leaders pledge financial support to the campaign. However, the financial support never came, and most pundits believe Bjelke-Petersen and his supporters were completely delusional. Unlike Queensland, Federal Australia did not have gerrymandered seats, and thus there was no way the Nationals could win a majority of seats to govern the coalition, yet alone the country. Capitalising on his opponent's disunity, Hawke would call a double dissolution election for the 11th of July 1987. The reason for a double dissolution election was due to the introduction of the Australian card, a national identification card for all Australians, which hoped to amalgamate all other forms of ID, such as driver's licences and Medicare cards. Despite being the reason for the double dissolution, Labor would not campaign on the card, instead focusing on the coalition's instability. Hawke had been very crafty calling the election when he did, as Bjelke-Petersen was visiting Disneyland in the United States, and thus was unable to nominate for a seat. Without a leader, the Joe for Canberra campaign movement would soon collapse. Some elements of the Nationals would keep the slogan, while others tried to run the idea of Sinclair for Prime Minister. Meanwhile, others would join back up with the Liberals. The result of this was a completely disorganised Nationals campaign in the lead up to the election. The Nationals weren't the only ones caught off guard. The Liberals too were not expecting such an early election, and thus would struggle to put forward an electoral agenda. During the campaign, the Liberals would miscalculate their tax cut proposals by almost $1 billion, and combined with the mass disunity, the Liberals looked completely unprepared to govern. Howard would attempt to get the better of Hawke in the leadership debates. However, Hawke, likely due to his previous performance, refused to debate Howard. And the winner was? For the first time in Australian history, Labor had won three elections in a row, with Hawke winning 86 seats, the most for any Labor government in Australian history. Labor's biggest wins were in Queensland, where they picked up four seats of the fractured coalition. Despite Labor's rather low two-party preferred result, the party was successful in winning over suburban voters, terrified at the prospects of a Bjelke-Petersen-led government. Meanwhile, John Howard would have to pick up the mess left by the Joe for Canberra campaign, with the Liberals and Nationals winning 43 and 19 seats respectively. Howard would not hold back on attacking Bjelke-Petersen for his dumb political stunt.
We are about to enter our third century as a nation, and whatever differences that divide us politically, and they are important differences, and they will remain important differences, those things that unite us as Australians are much greater and more enduring than those things that divide us.
The Joe for Canberra campaign would be the beginning of the end for Bjelke-Petersen and his Queensland Nationals. Facing a corruption investigation in his home state, Bjelke-Petersen would soon be deposed as leader of the Nationals, and the party would later be wiped out in the 1989 state election by the Labor Party under Wayne Goss, who would immediately dismantle the 1949 Electoral Districts Act. This ended the Nationals' electoral advantage, and since 1989 the coalition has only ever won one election in Queensland in 2012. To some in Labor, this was payback for Bjelke-Petersen's role in the 1975 dismissal of the Whitlam government. On an interesting note, to date, this is the last federal election in which no independents got elected, with all members of the lower house coming from one of the three main parties. Hawke had made Labor Party history, both by winning a third term as Prime Minister and avenging his predecessor Gough Whitlam. With a comfortable majority in the House, Hawke would soon look to his greatest electoral challenge yet, as I come back next time for the election of 1990.